Between 1485 and 1551, England was hit by at least 5 epidemics of a disease called sweating sickness. And sure, lots of illnesses can make you sweat, from food poisoning to the flu, but sweating sickness was much worse than its name would suggest. Symptoms like aches, fatigue, and yeah, sweating would get bad quickly, and you could die in just a few hours. Each epidemic of sweating sickness lasted several months and killed hundreds of people. But after the 1550s, the disease completely disappeared. Or did it? Researchers are working with some pretty spotty record keeping, but that hasn't stopped them from trying to figure out exactly what caused this mysterious, fleeting disease. Let's set the scene a little bit. The 1485 epidemic struck at the tail end of the Middle Ages, more than a century after the Black Death killed a third of the entire population of Europe, and a few decades after the Hundred Years' War, during which time a lot of people died for entirely different reasons. 1485 was also the year that Henry VII became king and founded the Tudor dynasty. His family plays a minor role in this story, so we'll be coming back to them. Meanwhile, the field of medicine was still pretty medieval. There were barber surgeons who would cut your hair, pull your teeth, or do some bloodletting. And basically, anyone could claim to be a physician, whether they had actually studied medical history at a university or just kind of gave out advice based on vibes. By the mid-1500s, Europe was now solidly in what historians call the early modern period, so technically not medieval. And Henry VII's son, Henry I Want to Divorce the Eighth, was both head of England and head of the new Church of England. Henry VIII also established what's now called the Royal College of Physicians, as well as the Guild of Barbers and Surgeons of London, to help regulate medical training a little better. But there was still plenty of vibes-based medicine happening, and we still didn't have a good understanding of microbiology. All of that to say, the 15th and 16th centuries were not the best time to get sick. Honestly, even the original documents from the time should be taken with a grain of salt. Even when physicians wrote down their observations about sweating sickness, the field of medicine was changing around them. And when modern researchers dig into those sources, it's important to think about whose lives and deaths were being recorded and whose were ignored. The puzzle pieces researchers use to understand the mystery of sweating sickness come from 3 main buckets of primary sources. First, any letters and newspapers that happened to mention the disease, which didn't just go by sweating sickness. This thing went by a bunch of names, including Pseudor Anglicus, the English sweat, or just the sweat. Second, a couple of fairly reputable physicians wrote down eyewitness accounts. A French physician named Thomas Forestier lived in England around the first pandemic in 1485 and published 2 treatises about the sweat. And there's a whole book about the 1551 epidemic and the history of sweating sickness by an English physician who tried on different names throughout his lifetime, so we'll just call him John Keyes. The third bucket of primary sources is a patchy collection of parish registers. These local church records ramped up around the time of Henry VIII's reign and documented important life events like marriages and deaths. By stitching these accounts together, researchers think there were 5 summers between 1485 and 1551 when sweating sickness spread fast and far enough to be classified as an epidemic in England. Outbreaks usually peaked in June to August, but one was recorded as early as April and another lasted as late as December. In 1529, the disease raged across the entire continent of Europe. But before I tell you about what happened next, a quick ad. This SciShow video is supported by Brilliant, an interactive online learning platform. Brilliant is all about problem solving and critical thinking, not memorizing. If you've ever tried to help a kid with schoolwork only to realize you don't remember any of the stuff you crammed right before all those tests, then you get why Brilliant's approach matters. To break those bad habits you might have formed way back when, Brilliant sprinkles puzzles and quizzes throughout their lessons, and they top it off with daily encouragement to keep you on track and feeling good about finishing what you started. You can give it a try for free at brilliant.org/scishow, the QR code on screen, or the link in the video description. You'll also get 20% off an annual premium subscription. Wherever and whenever the sweat popped up, it struck suddenly and intensely. The symptoms made you miserable fast. Aches and chills, fever, fatigue, intense stinky sweating, and difficulty breathing, to name a few. And like I mentioned earlier, death could happen within the day, possibly due to intense dehydration from all that sweating. It's a little hard to estimate how likely you were to die, so there are numbers ranging from 5% to 90% in different modern-day papers, although many researchers land somewhere between 30 and 50%. This variation could be from lots of factors, like the quality of record keeping, whether people lived in urban city centers or the rural countryside, or the quality of medical care, including some physicians who may have made things worse. We can thank John Keyes for his record keeping, but he and other physicians had some questionable treatment suggestions. They wanted to make these patients sweat out the disease, whether by piling clothes on top of them, or rubbing their skin, or giving them warm drinks. Keyes also recommended keeping them awake at all costs by making them smell vinegar and rose water, slapping them with rosemary sprigs, or pulling on their ears, nose, or hair. Because that was the state of medicine, it's no surprise there were all kinds of hot takes about what caused sweating sickness too. Some blamed evil air, or the physical filth inside and outside of homes. Others pointed at religious causes, like a disaster from God, or being a Lutheran, or being a Catholic. Oh, and I forgot to mention all the religious turmoil that England was swimming in at the time, which is only partially the Tudors' fault. A handful of contemporary records seem to say that rich young men were most likely to get sick, whether or not that was actually true. Again, the record keepers could have been biased. But also, when people get violently sick and die suddenly, survivors might exaggerate just how bad everything was. In any case, we know that sweating sickness freaked people out, especially Henry VIII. There are reports of him fleeing London in 1517 and again in 1528 to avoid those two epidemics, even as members of his household got sick, including Anne Boleyn and her dad. So that's at least one thing Showtime's series The Tudors managed to get historically accurate. It's a little hard to tell what happened to sweating sickness after 1551. Diseases come and go throughout history as humans build immunity and microbes mutate, so it could have disappeared as mysteriously as it arose. But we also might be missing records, or this collection of symptoms might have been called something else as time went on. One paper published in 2018 seems to have found a bunch of sources throughout the 19th century that point to cases of sweating sickness from 1483 all the way to 1802. Whether sweating sickness is gone for good or still around under a different name, scientists love a good mystery. And now that we have the power of microbiology and much more robust medical knowledge, there's lots of speculation out there. Researchers have thrown out a laundry list of bacterial and viral suggestions that cause sweating and those other symptoms, from anthrax to influenza. But the most recent hypothesis revolves around hantavirus. The timing of the English outbreaks for a few months after a wet spring season sort of resemble epidemics that were spread by hantavirus vectors, namely rodents, and the symptoms mirror the intensity of a disease called hantavirus pulmonary syndrome. But that being said, it's still speculation. We can't just go grave digging in a parish where people died of sweating sickness, and not just for ethical reasons. While we can sometimes extract and amplify really old DNA fragments from human tissue, the RNA that makes up hantavirus genomes isn't a very stable molecule by comparison. In the super rare occasions that we have found preserved viral RNA, it's been on ice in permafrost, not in the fluctuating temperatures of the English countryside. And even then, any old RNA data we have isolated has been tricky to verify. One of the most frustrating things about historical medical mysteries is that we may never know what diseases these now dead people contracted because we can't use our modern tools, and any records that we have are always going to be flawed in some way. But that doesn't stop scientists and historians from sweating the details and trying to find out.